not on, right? Hello, everyone. My name. Oh, that's loud. This is the 5-minute warning. If you haven't had a chance to grab a drink or grab some food, you might grab that really quickly. Also, for folks who are in the back, there's a bunch of seats up here in front if you want to get closer. And we'll kick it off in just a few minutes. Well, good evening, everybody. Welcome to the Alliance for Sustainable Colorado. My name is Jacob Smith. I work at the Alliance. We are thrilled that, holy cow, what a crowd. We're so excited to have all of you here tonight. Thank you all for coming. I want to first I'll tell you, the panel tonight is entitled What Colorado Can Learn from California State Action on Energy and Climate. If you were looking for a different panel, you're in the wrong place. But hopefully you're here for that one. How many of you have never been here before? How many of you, this is your first event at the Alliance? Oh, that is amazing. We're really, really pleased to welcome all of you here. Thank you all for coming, and welcome back to all the rest of you who have come to events here before. The work we do here and the work we're gonna talk about this evening is very much focused on collaboration. Tonight we've got folks from California who are gonna, this is really collaboration between the states, and they're gonna share lessons and insights that should help us do better collaboration, better work here within the state of Colorado. I wanna recognize Senator Matt Jones. Thank you very much for being here. It's also super helpful when state legislators make it, because this is the place where those conversations happen. And there's some others who are planning to come, haven't seen them yet, but they all warned me they may be late. So we'll probably see some more come in later. The event tonight is part of a series that we're hosting with our good friends at the Worth Chair in Sustainable Development. I'm going to introduce Mark in a few minutes, but I want to tell you a little bit about the Alliance and about the series first. The Alliance for Sustainable Colorado, well, we're based here in this building. We own the building. Both nonprofits and for-profits alike. And we've long had a focus here on at the Alliance on energy and climate. And we know that the challenges posed by the need to transform our energy system to a clean energy system and the challenges posed by climate change are enormous and enormously complex. And we also know that they require incredibly powerful collaborations if we're going to be able to match our solutions to the scale of the problem. But the problem is, as many of you know, that collaborations kind of suck. They're often really hard. They often involve lots of wheels spinning. They involve burning lots of resources and lots of time. And yet they're so important to be able to do the work that we know we need to do. So our focus here at the heart of what we do at the Alliance is foster and support and lead collaborations that enable all the groups, many of you who are here, groups in the building, groups across Colorado, to do work that really does match the scale of the problem. Some of that is the building itself. We've designed the building to foster serendipity and magic and amazing collaborations between organizations, across movements and across sectors. All of that happens here all the time. We lead and support collaborations in the community and in Colorado. And then we host events like this. This event is very much part of the collaborative work we do. We bring a bunch of folks together so we can have conversations about what that path forward looks like. And tonight in particular, learn a bunch about the lessons learned and experiences and insights of the incredible work that our friends in, you're gonna meet them in just a minute, our friends in California have been doing. I wanna make sure I don't miss anything I need to tell you. I have a long list, but I'm almost done. I wanna tell you a little bit about the sustainability series, which is the event tonight. This is the kickoff for 2017. We don't anticipate, this will not surprise any of you, we don't expect a lot of proactive activity or change at the federal level this year. Maybe not for more than this year. Our interest is focusing on the state level, where we know there's both enormous opportunity and enormous need to do great work. And that's the place where we think we're going to be best able to move the ball forward. And the sustainability series recognizes that. So instead of focusing on the federal government, the sustainability series with the Worth Chair is focused on the state level, and particularly what we can learn from folks in other places, other states, other regions, to help support the amazing collaborations we know we need here in Colorado to move the ball forward. Tonight's talk is focused on California, and you'll meet those folks in just a few minutes. California, as you all know, is at the leading edge
on climate and energy both. On May 9th, we have another sustainability series event focused on Hawaii. And those of you who don't know, Hawaii, first state in the country to adopt a 100% renewable energy generation goal, which is incredibly exciting. We've got Hawaii folks coming. We'll learn a bunch from them. In the fall, in September, we have another one with some folks from the European Union, which is also see some incredibly ambitious and innovative work there. So tonight's event brings together two very exceptional guests, and Mark is going to introduce them. I'm first going to introduce Mark. Mark is actually the Wirth Chair at the Wirth Chair in Sustainable Development at the University of Colorado, Denver. Mark has a couple of decades of experience as a lawyer on energy projects, making some of the biggest, most important renewable energy developments across the country actually happen. And we're thrilled to have Mark tonight as the moderator. And could you all help me welcome Mark?
Thanks. You want to see my Wirth Chair? A lot of jokes. One of the faculty members at the School of Public Affairs, where the Wirth Chair is housed, typically comes by about once a week. If I'm not in my chair at my desk, he'll point at the chair and say, "Is that the Wirth Chair?" Those of you who don't know, the Wirth Chair was endowed by friends of former Senator Tim Wirth about almost 20 years ago, 18 years ago. And it has a modest endowment, which continues to provide income for the chair's activities since being appointed, much to my surprise and delight, a little over 3 years ago to the Wirth Chair. We have brought a decided focus on energy and climate to the chair's works. My colleague at the Wirth Chair, Jennifer Kagan, our director, will be here with us a little later this evening. She had to go to class tonight. She's working towards her PhD in public affairs at the school while working at the Wirth Chair. But we did a series of events that we've done for a number of years, a series of events called the Sustainability Series. And as Jacob mentioned, this year's focus is a little tighter. And we've drawn this down from what was 10 events last year to 4 this year. And something a little different is happening this year. As we progress through these events, with the assistance of Melissa here in the front, one of our interns from the School of Public Affairs, we're going to be producing a pretty extensive white paper that will discuss the topics that are addressed at these events, some further research and analysis into their appropriateness for adoption or consideration in Colorado. And in the fourth event of the year, in December or November, we'll be bringing that white paper forward and asking all of you who have come back, and especially doubling down on inviting our state leadership to come to that last event and discuss that white paper. We have a very outcome kind of oriented agenda in the sustainability series this year, which is called for, I think, in these extraordinary times. So we've been here before. We collectively in this country have been here before. We've been in situations repeatedly over the last generations where states kind of had to up their game in particular areas of activity, of policy and leadership, because the federal government was in the hands of the opposition party, regardless of which party we're affiliated with or what belief system we adhere to. But we're back here again in the context of climate and energy, sort of with a vengeance, if you will, at this point. And we have to figure out what we can do and how we can do it. And in the energy context, and in the clean energy context, this country existed for about 150 years before the federal government had any role at all in energy. Everything was conducted and regulated at the state or local level. And in 1927, the United States Supreme Court issued a case that all the lawyers who work in the energy field are aware of. It's called the Attleboro Steam Case. And it was the first time the United States federal government took an active role in the regulation of electric energy. The Federal Power Act followed in 1935 and was the act that is still in force today that says essentially that the federal government and the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission have jurisdiction over the transmission of electricity in interstate commerce. If it happens among multiple states, the federal government has jurisdiction. And the federal government also has jurisdiction over the wholesale market for electricity, not the market that our utilities operate in delivering power to us as individual consumers or to businesses, But the wholesale market that happens that takes place between generators of electricity and those companies that distribute it wholesale. That leaves an awful lot to the states. It leaves a tremendous amount of activity, including things like siting power plants, including things like directing utilities that are within the states as to the composition of their power supply, as to the nature of their service, as to how they recover costs from their service. And we've had tussles over the last number of years, and quite a few in the last several years, around the scope and extent of that state power. There's a thing in the United States Constitution that only obscure and sort of demented lawyers know about. It's called the Dormant Commerce Clause. All good constitutional lawyers know what the Dormant Commerce Clause is, but essentially it's a clause that stands for the proposition that states can't go too far in regulating activities within their state if they impact interstate commerce between the states. Now, over the last decade in particular, since renewable portfolio standards have been adopted by states, there's been a lot of litigation about what the state's rights and opportunities are. And for the most part, these cases have been decided favorably to the states. Just that little bit of background. And now I want to introduce you to these wonderful speakers that we pulled together for tonight. We could not have, in my opinion, rung the bell any better in terms of California resources to come and talk to us. Scott Anders will be speaking to us first. Scott is here with us from the University of San Diego Law School. I imagine just about everybody introduces you, Scott, mentions that you're not a lawyer. I think people feel compelled to make sure that everybody's clear on that. But he runs the Energy Policy Innovation Center at the University of San Diego Law School. Scott has his master's degree in public policy from Maryland and has been active in a number of capacities with a number of organizations in the development and analysis of energy policy in California for a number of years. An expert, truly an expert on the subject of California policies on clean energy and climate change. Scott will make a presentation for a little bit, and then he'll be followed by Hillary Hebert. I won't stand up to introduce Hillary again. I'll just do it now. Hillary, on the other hand, is a lawyer. But as it turns out, one of the best I've ever known. Hillary is a graduate of the University of Denver School of Law. She went to DU. I don't want to put years on this, Hillary, but maybe 17 years ago, 15, 16 years ago, she graduated. And she took an amazing job just out of law school. She went to work for a law firm where I was a partner and ran an energy and infrastructure practice and was one of my young associates. Then she went off the rails and got married to this guy from San Diego, or they moved there together. We kind of lost contact with each other. And when I went searching for an expert in the utility world, someone who worked with inside of a major utility in California, there she was. Her name kept coming up. Hillary is the manager for policy and strategy at San Diego Gas and Electric. And it can tell us from the utility's perspective how these policies and programs in California are managed by the utility companies, how they're implemented, what works, what doesn't. And I don't want to steal any of her thunder, but she was telling me in the meeting we had before we started tonight something I didn't know, which is that San Diego Gas and Electric, on a megawatt hour basis, now provides 43% of their energy in the form of clean, renewable energy, 43%. That's a pretty remarkable accomplishment. So without further fuss or ado, I'm going to get Scott up here, turn him loose, and let him educate us, prompt us, be provocative. And we'll wrap up and with plenty of time for Q&A at the end, and I'll be back up at that point. Scott, thank you.
Is this on? Thank you, Jacob and Mark. Don't clap yet, I haven't even gotten started. Let me do this quick change. Hello, is that good? Let's see. Again, thank you, Mark, Jacob, for the generous invitation. And thank you all for coming out. I'm always heartened to see people who come out in the evening, take time out of their personal lives to come to something like this and hear people like me and Hillary drone on about energy stuff. So it's great to see you. Thank you so much for coming up. As Mark mentioned, what I'd like to do is maybe do a bit of a higher level flyby, talking about California's energy and climate policy framework. And then I'm gonna focus in a little bit on clean energy and or clean electricity, and I'll explain why I'm gonna do that. I'm gonna look both at large scale and rooftop solar, kind of large scale, small scale. And then I'm gonna talk a little bit about some of the emerging issues or some of the observations that I and others have made about what's happening in California. So a little bit about our center. Our center is not that dissimilar from the Worth Chair. We're a policy shop based at the law school. Yes, I am one of the few non-lawyers at the law school, but there it is. And we were founded in 2005, and I was brought in as the founding director, and I'm still there, still going. We have kind of a two-part mission. One is to conduct research and analysis on energy issues in our region, in the state of California. We don't do a ton at the federal level because it's a crowded area and there's a lot going on in California to keep us busy. We also educate decision makers and law students. So we have a staff attorney on our staff who runs a clinic. We also have a course. We have several courses that are available to students. We also have an endowment, and that's how we're funded in part. We also have grants and contracts to keep our fund, to supplement our endowment funding. I'm going to make the case tonight, and it may be obvious, but sometimes it isn't that obvious to people who look at energy policy in California and anywhere for that matter. But I'm going to make the argument, again, I don't think it's going to be a stretch, that energy policy is climate policy. And it starts from there. It doesn't start from wanting clean electrons, it starts from reducing carbon emissions and greenhouse gas emissions in the atmosphere. And that is the peak. But before we get started, I wanted to kind of talk a little bit about the California mindset. You know, California has a bit of a superiority complex sometimes. You know, we are a very large state. We are a very large economy, something like the sixth or seventh largest economy in the world. And we have such a mindset that we actually call ourselves a republic. This is the state flag. So just, I want you to know where we're coming from here. So this is some evidence of that that perspective. This was last fall. Jerry Brown was at the American Geophysical Union talking to a bunch of climate scientists about what might happen under a Trump administration. And there was some concern about the satellites. And you can see what Jerry Brown said. He basically said, we'll launch our own damn satellites. So this is the kind of the... but this is kind of how California thinks sometimes, right? California thinks, hey, you know, we're basically a nation and we're so big we can move the needle. I've been making the argument in California, in San Diego, that particularly with people who aren't in this day to day, that energy policy is climate policy. And sometimes people say, well, climate policy is political and can't say climate change. Greenhouse gas is a dirty word, no pun intended. And so I disagree. And you know, Commissioner Weissenmiller from the California Energy Commission said this at a recent event, our energy policy is really based upon climate policy. So 2006, California adopts a bill called AB 32. Again, note the hubris. It's the Global Warming Solutions Act of 2006. And you know, you can see that our goal is ending global warming. I think it's a noble goal, don't get me wrong, but again, it kind of shows how California thinks. And it was signed by then Governor Schwarzenegger, who was another prominent reality or now reality TV star politician of a different sort perhaps. But this is kind of what got it all started. This was a statutory greenhouse gas limit. Statutory. So it said that California had to reduce its emissions by law. And I'm gonna work from that level down to energy, and we'll get into the weeds a bit, but really wanna set the context that it's really about It's about reducing greenhouse gases. This shows California's mix in, I think, 2014. Transportation is clearly the largest, followed by the two electrics, and then the residential and commercial are basically natural gas. So if you kind of think of those as buildings, that's a huge portion. Transportation, cars and trucks, that's effectively emissions in California. We have ambitious targets, very ambitious targets now in law, at least for 2020 and 2030. So you can see that in 2020, we have to reach 1990 levels, and that's AB 32 by law. By 2030, it's 40% below 1990 levels. By law now, that's SB 32, kind of a clever bicameral usage of the AB, SB. And this line, it kind of follows an executive order which says California should be 80% below 1990 by 2050. And these are the so-called scientific imperative targets to keep below 2 degrees C warming globally. So, you know, when you look at this, you know, you see a cliff, practically a cliff. These are very, very deep cuts. We've done a lot of analysis on greenhouse gas reductions in California. 2020 is basically where, you know, it's tomorrow, we're basically there. 2030 gets way harder. 2050, I can't even think about that yet. It is, you know, 80% below by 2050. That's, I'm getting one slide ahead of myself. That's too many. Right now, California is about 10. 2030, you're at 6. 2050, you're at 2 tons per person. I think Jacob said it well when he said that this is a big challenge with big consequences, but it's a significant challenge. And I think anybody who tells you otherwise is foolish. So California, this thing, it's under 2 metric tons to keep us under 2 degrees Celsius. And it's an attempt to work with subnationals. So in our country, there has not been a lot of federal policy around climate and energy. And so again, California, thinking like it's California, went off and said, well, we're just going to work with other subnationals. We're going to work with other cities and other regions around the world, and has done that for the last several COP agreement conferences around the world. And this is the latest effort to try to create a subnational movement, over a billion people, $25 trillion in GDP. That's the current signatories, represents the current signatories. Okay, so big challenge. We have to get down to 2 metric tons and hopefully not degrees. So how do we do that? If you sort of boil it down, things are pretty simple. And I'm a kind of a framework guy. I like to boil things down to the essence. I want to see what's the framework, what is the kind of the essence of it, and then you kind of got to get into the details. So, you know, the basic structure here is pretty basic. We just have to reduce the level of polluting activity. So that would be like energy efficiency for buildings, vehicle standards for cars, that kind of thing. Just use less of the resource of the, you know, reduce the polluting activity. And then the next step is to decarbonize electricity, and then we need to electrify other things like cars and water heaters, for example. And there are other things, and I'll talk about that in a second, but these are kind of the main things. Reduce activity, decarbonize electricity, electrify transportation and other loads like natural gas. And if you think about it, that puts decarbonizing electricity kind of in the middle. So decarbonizing electricity is probably the most important step to address climate issues when you look at it in this framework. People, I jokingly say the future of energy is electricity. I mean, it's kind of a silly phrase, but it really is. We will shift increasingly to electricity. And of course, our digital world is will demand more and more high quality power. So the future of energy is electricity. And this is one reason. Sure. I assume so. Slides be available? Sure. So I'm not going to talk about transportation very much. I'm not going to talk about fuel switching with natural gas. I think Hillary's going to talk a bit about transportation and EVs. I'm going to touch on it a bit. But I'm going to talk really about this center decarbonization. And again, talk about it at a large scale resources and then kind of smaller scale resources. So this is taking that framework. This is kind of California's policy in one slide. You know, and I should back up and say, you know, any one topic that I'm going to raise tonight, you know, we could talk about for a whole day or a week. So this is really going to be a, you know, hopefully try to get some concepts out and spark some discussion. California has a target of 50% renewable by 2030. We have a goal of doubling efficiency. Here's a takeaway. Don't write things in law like double efficiency. Think about it, right? So don't do that. But the way we increase efficiency or reduce energy consumption in buildings, that would be better language, is building standards, appliance standards, and energy efficiency programs. Those are kind of the basic pillars of that. Of that piece. And then reducing fossil fuel, we have zero emission vehicle programs, largely electric vehicles and plug-in hybrids. We have a low carbon fuel standard, which seeks to reduce the carbon intensity of a gallon of fuel. Most of that is happening upstream at the refinery rather than in the gallon itself. In other words, there are really no tailpipe emission reduction. It's all happening upstream. Nonetheless, if you think about embedded carbon, it's happening in the fuel in the supply chain in California. And there's also an effort to reduce miles driven. That would be reducing the activity. So more walk, more bike, more transit. By the way, kudos for the putting in the train to the airport. Hillary and I flew in, jumped on the train. We were dropped off at Union Station and we're staying at the, what's our hotel called?
Crawford.
The Crawford. So, and then we walked here. It was great. You can't do that in San Diego. Cannot do that in San Diego. Not even close. Not yet. Thank you. I like your optimism. So kudos. It was great. We reduced some vehicle miles traveled. This is the basic framework. Again, tons of details, but this is the framework. We also have a cap and trade program where you can trade emissions. I'm gonna talk a little bit about that. These are important because California has been doing this for a long time, relatively long time, and we're starting to. The low-hanging fruit is gone, and we're looking for the next generation of reductions. And so we're looking at short-lived climate pollutants. Those are things like methane, which have a much higher global warming potential. They trap more heat in the atmosphere, but they live. Their life in the atmosphere is much shorter. But if you can get them out of the atmosphere now, they can help with the longer-term warming. Focusing on refinery emissions and sustainable freight. So these are things that were kind of nice to have. You know, longer term, but we're kind of there. We're, you know, efficiency, transportation, and clean energy. We see what we need to do there, and we're working down those pathways. These are new, so these are some new areas that we're working in. Okay, decarbonize electricity, and yes, I follow the California ISO on Twitter, so that should tell you enough about what kind of a geek I am. So the California ISO is the independent system operator, which kind of manages all the electricity in California. So I was lying, I usually do it at night, I'm lying in bed and I see this tweet, another generation peak of just over 9,000 megawatts set at 146 today, replacing the old one. And then the next night I saw this one. So this was the next day we had a new solar record. And I expect that if I came back in a month or so, there would be three or four more of these solar records. Point is, we're putting in a lot of solar in California, and it's changing the way our grid interacts. And so, you know, you can never think about all the outcomes, but you should try to think it through a little bit. And the good news is that others are further ahead. I'm not saying that's a good thing for your, but you can learn from others, right? Others are already, other people, we've already had the problem. So you can look to at least to see how we've addressed some of these things. So lots of solar. It's a great thing, right? Generally speaking, that is a good thing. However, it kind of goes against the way that the grid typically has worked. This is a crazy question. How many people have ever heard of the duck curve? Wow, I'm astounded. That's great. So the duck curve. This is March 2nd. So just to quickly explain what's going on here, the top lines that go along here are projected in an actual demand, what we actually needed. And then when you subtract out the renewable electricity, you get that green dip, which is the belly of the duck. Some people, I don't know, I see a seahorse, you know, it could be a lot of things, but we call it the duck curve. So this is a really important issue because you have power plants ramping up in the morning, a lot of gas, and then having to ramp down significantly down to the belly of the duck, so to speak. And then demand then rises again in the afternoon, and there are significant ramps. And this will continue to get worse as more and more solar gets put on the system. Now, I should tell you that I don't want to say March 2nd is the perfect storm, but this is the time of year when we get a lot of solar. Our demand is very low because it's still cool, lots of sun. These shoulder months, particularly in the spring, this is a bit exacerbated. Nonetheless, this is a particularly important issue. How do you integrate high, you know, this is 9,000 and what is it, 66 megawatts. I mean, we're pushing 10 gigawatts, which is just astounding. So what are we going to do about that? How do we integrate more solar? I don't expect you to read all this, but the slides will be available for later. So one trend that we're seeing, Europe is doing this, California is certainly doing this, is we're saying, hey, you know, we have this duck curve problem. We need to fix it. Well, one way you fix it is by broadening the diversity of the resources that you can bring into the grid. And so the California Independent System Operator has developed something called the Energy Imbalance Market. It's basically allowing a lot more power from many more geographic areas to be traded across time to smooth out some of these gaps and these differences. If you think about it, it makes a lot of sense, right? You get temporal diversity. So when it peaks in Arizona or Nevada, it may not be peaking in California. And you get different renewable productions, north and south. You get the latitudinal and the longitudinal diversity, which matters when you're trying to keep the lights on. Oh, I was going to skip this slide, but here it popped up. But anyway, energy storage is another area that we're seeing in California. California has a law. I know Hillary's going to talk about this, but I'm not going to talk about it too much. But I'll just stop there. You know, can we strategically store energy and move it around in time to use it to help out with that duck curve? So some questions for food for thought. What level of renewables can be sustained? We're at 43%. We're going to 50% by law in California. Can we do 75? Can we do 80? City of San Diego has a climate action plan which seeks 100% renewable. Can you do 100% renewable? And by when? And what would that entail? What kind of storage facilities or what kind of integration would you need to get to 100%? Is the regional approach that the California ISO is looking at, is that the way to go? So you increase the geographical diversity of supply to balance out those differences? What role can distributed resources play? I'm going to talk a bit about this at the end. I believe that distributed energy resources in the form of energy efficiency, demand reduction, energy storage, mobile energy storage in the form of electric vehicles, and distributed generation like rooftop solar can all be combined to modulate demand in a way to integrate renewables, much, much more so than we're doing it today. I'll talk about that in a bit. Is energy storage key, and what role could flexible load play? So these are kind of some of the issues that we're grappling with in California. How do you deal with the operational changes to the grid when you have high levels of renewables? And in our case, they're predominantly solar, which is a very predictable pattern, yet it still creates this integration issue. And by the way, we have a lot of gas on the system that doesn't run when solar is producing a lot. So you have assets that aren't being used as well. Okay, distributed photovoltaics. I'm going to talk a little bit. So that's kind of we're decarbonizing the grid, basically. Now we're talking about what about the homeowner, the business, the school. Does this building have solar on it?
Yes.
this building someday, who wants to self-generate some of their own electricity. So in California, we have a lot of rooftop solar, 650,000 systems, about 6 gigawatts. So the other number that I showed you, the 9,000 megawatts, that's large scale. This is in addition, but this is distributed. I was telling Hillary earlier, when I came to San Diego in 1999, there were 10 photovoltaic systems. Now there are 100,000 and 600 megawatts. It's pretty impressive. So I'm going to talk a little bit about how we got here and, again, some of the lessons learned. I would argue that there are three pieces to the California solar market. Net energy metering. Do people know what net energy metering is? Heads nodding, yeah, no, I see no, yes. So I can explain that just briefly. Financial incentives and rate structures. We'll start with financial. California had a very generous California incentive program called the California Solar Initiative. The goal was 1,750 megawatts of rooftop solar, $2 billion budget over 10 years. And one of the nice things about this, I think, is a lesson. You know, I was thinking about this, and I was thinking, putting like a little thumbs up or a thumbs, whatever this is. For net metering, I would say it would be like this. For financial incentives, I would say it's like this. And for electric rates, I would probably say it's like this. And I'll explain what I mean by that. I actually skipped this slide. I got trigger happy. You don't need to see all this either, but this kind of gets to the fast pace of growth in the San Diego market. But it also speaks to the idea that a new area of policy development, you dip your toe in the pool. Is it working? How is it working? Then you expand it a little bit. And I think that's OK. But what it does, it creates uncertainty in the marketplace. It creates stops and starts. Mark, if you've developed wind over your career, the investment tax credit or the production tax credit was on again, off again, on again, off again. And you could see the product, you know, the installations going up and down as this herky. You know, I tell people my crystal ball is as cloudy as anybody else's, so I can't tell the future. But this herky-jerky nature of net metering, I think, was a downside. I don't think it was something that was helpful to the market. It didn't hold the market back, but it wasn't helpful. So then we have the California Solar Initiative. Sorry, I bounced back there. The nice thing about the California Solar Initiative is that it was 10 years long. It created some certainty in the market to photovoltaic manufacturers and installers that they were going to get financial incentives for 10 years and $2 billion worth, which is a ton of money. By the way, it's all ratepayer funded. The other nice thing is that it declined over time, so that as the industry developed, they got less and less of an incentive. So the idea was that the incentive goes away in 10 years. And if the project was designed well and managed well, at the end of 10 years, you don't need the incentive anymore. And in fact, most of the residential projects happening now, and at least in San Diego, don't get any of this money anymore. So the market is sort of standing on its own. There are still federal tax credits, but it's working. Again, I'm sorry to be, I don't want to be a Californian. California alone didn't cause the market, you know, the global market for solar panels to happen, but it was a piece of that. These are some installed photovoltaic prices since 1998 to 2015. Again, this is US, not just California, but you can see that the trend is going down. That's why systems now don't need incentives, or need the incentives as much as they needed in the past in California, or most markets in California. This is one of my favorite subjects to talk about, but I'm not going to go into the weeds too much. Maybe in the Q&A period we can talk about it. But if you're interested in energy, particularly electric energy, you really need to understand how rates work. They're super important. We teach a class called Energy Law and Policy. It's kind of like intro to electric and natural gas regulation. And I tell the students, you really should know about rates. Of course, it's the most boring and most arcane thing that you could ever talk about, but it's super important. It drives the economics for just about everything, right? If you want to put in new large-scale renewable, it has to be cost-effective with the current rate. If you want to put a solar panel on your roof, how do you figure out if it's cost effective? Is it going to be cheaper than what I'm paying now? I want to put in LED lights. Is it cheaper than what I have now? So really understanding the rates is critically important. This is I couldn't state this more emphatically, huge lesson learned here. No offense to the legislators in the room, but this was California. After the energy crisis, which was terrible, right, in the late 90s, early 2000s in California, the state legislature, in its infinite wisdom, put a cap on certain residential rates. And so what they did was, before the energy crisis, the residential system was a tiered rate structure. The more you use, the more that incremental unit costs you. And the idea there is it gives a little bit of a conservation incentive. And said no more cost increase. Let's go up. We have, you know, gas put into the upper tiers, to the it's on the bottom. Bad idea to legislate rates, I think. It's a really bad idea. But anyway, on the positive side, it was really kind of a distortion in the market, right? It created users, but it didn't create any signal for the people at the bottom. Not to say that they should get maybe the upper tiers should be penalized in a way, but the lower tier should feel some of the pain too. And so now what California is doing is kind of doing like this to get those rates kind of more equal. Oh, sorry. You know what? I'm going to take it out and do that. Is that better? Sorry about that. This is being remedied, but this was a huge driver for the solar market. I wouldn't recommend creating rates like this in order to drive solar. I think that's a bad idea. But this happened, and it happened after a crisis, and maybe understandably so, but not to be recommended. Let me go back to this for a second. What one thing that I notice about this chart is it almost looks, I mean, this is actual data, but it almost looks like somebody did it to be smooth, right? It's very orderly growth. And I think that is in part because of the solar incentive program we had, that it created stepwise growth and incentives went away over time. I think it was a really good program. I think this is in part because of that. I think that there's room for debate about whether or not you pick winners and losers with policy like this. Do you incent the outcome, or do you incentivize the specific technology? I think that's an important question, particularly around carbon/energy policy, and I'm going to talk about that toward the end. Okay, questions going forward. The good news is we have a lot of solar. The bad news is the old solar net metering program created a situation where non-net metered customers paid for net metered customers. I have solar on my home. I'm a net producer on an annual basis, and my electric bill at the end of the year it's actually negative, but for all intents and purposes, it's zero. I pay nothing. So during the day when I'm at work and the kids are at school, I'm exporting power to the grid. Right now, I don't know what time it is there, but if it were this time at my house, my family would be home having dinner, and we'd be pulling power from the grid. We use the grid every day, yet we pay nothing for the grid. Ten systems to 100,000 systems and growing. So there's a real question of how do you deal, is this a subsidy? How much of a subsidy is this? How do you remedy this? Are rooftop solar systems benefiting all income groups? Do they have enough money to buy them? Can they avail themselves of this $2 billion in subsidies? I should say that as time went on, this became an issue, and some of the money was set aside for certain disadvantaged communities. Are solar producers being fairly compensated for their electricity? I would argue they're being compensated too much, and maybe I'll throw that out there and you can push back in the Q&A period. Are solar customers adequately contributing to the fixed cost of the system? Are me and my family contributing to the upkeep of the grid? And the answer is no, because we pay, at least now, we pay zero. And we're grandfathered in. There's a new net metering, but we're grandfathered in. By the way, why do we say grandfathered? Is it grandmothered?
If you enter the rates, you still have the same rates you had before, but don't you still pay a service and facility charge with SPP?
I think we pay, you know, there's a fee, but it's a $5 a month or something fee. Something like this, and my understanding is that's for the meter, it's for customer service, it's for meter reading, billing. It's a kind of an administrative service rather than like a customer charge. Let me just move on in the interest of time. Okay, emerging issues. Complexity. This was a report put out that shows at least attempts to map out all the renewable energy policies and programs in California. I know what these programs are, and I can't even understand this thing. California has an exceedingly complicated system for different size, for different market segments. Very complicated. And it was sort of like renewable energy by accretion or by increment. And when you sort of stop and look at where you've come, you get something like this. So one thing that I would definitely say is, you know, be careful about heaping on the next policy and understand how it fits in with the existing policies that you already have. Enough said, right? I mean, this is just very complicated. Okay, this is the hype curve. If you haven't seen this, you need to see this. Do that. Solar, EVs, and now storage have fallen prey to the hype curve. So the hype curve, you have the technology introduced, and then you have the peak of inflated expectations. There's going to be solar on every rooftop by the end of 2010. Half the cars driven in San Diego are going to be EVs by 2020, you know, these kinds of things. It's just not, you know, you sort of have to modulate your expectations. Then you have the trough of disillusionment, slope of enlightenment, and the plateau of productivity. Things take time, right? When I got to San Diego in 1999, and by the way, I'm not saying there's any correlation here or causation. I got to San Diego in 1999, there were 10 systems, now there are 100,000 systems. Yeah, we have a lot, we have 600 megawatts, but it took 15 years for that market to develop. It takes time, these things take time. Supply chains take time, market development takes time. I do think though, that energy storage, because it has it's sort of riding in the wake of, or in the slipstream of solar, if you will, that it could potentially be brought to market quicker. I would say, very simply, solar was a more mature technology with a very immature market, and I would say that storage is a less mature technology with a relatively developed market. So I think, but beware. Energy storage is a great thing, but I think it's still gonna take time before we all have Tesla power walls in our garage. Disadvantaged communities, I mentioned this a couple of times. This has become a major issue in California around energy policy. There's we track California legislation, and there are numerous bills this year dealing with this issue around funds raised, around how policies are money is distributed, how policies are directed, who can participate. Huge issue, huge issue. And I mean, I'm happy to talk more about this, but as our energy and climate policy has progressed, again, this keeps coming up as a major issue. Policy integration. I think this might be the right now in California, the biggest issue is how do you integrate energy policy around that really is governed by the Public Utilities Commissioner. In this case, we also have the California Energy Commission, which is geared more toward, I mean, the policies are geared more toward energy. And we have the California Air Resources Board, who in AB 32 and SB 32 is tasked and given authority to run programs and reduce emissions. So we have some programs around energy efficiency, renewable energy, energy storage, distributed energy, and then we have some around greenhouse gases. And I think what we're figuring out is, wait, how do all these things fit together? Where does one agency's authority begin and another agency's authority stop? And what if the energy efficiency program is really successful? What effect does that have on these other areas and vice versa? We found that there's a really interesting relationship between efficiency and renewables. Maybe we can talk about that in the Q&A as well. I think this is also a growing issue. We have, in California, we have the California ISO. So we have large-scale renewables, large-scale power plants. And by the way, at that, I mentioned earlier, the trend there is to go big, right? We're growing the area where we're pulling power from. But at the very same time, I mean, I have solar on my house. I know a lot of people that have solar also have EVs. I think it's very likely that storage comes behind at some point. And how do you integrate those resources? If we can modulate demand, how do you connect that up into the wholesale market? How do you connect the dots there? And the way we currently do it is around utility rates and tariffs, or tariffs not in the import tariff way, but that's what we call utility rate structures. And they're kind of misaligned at the moment. And so we need to do some work on how do we integrate all those resources at the end, at the node or at the edge, and with the system. Last slide. I think that in California, we are getting along the lines of the agencies being overlapping. A lot of energy policy still looks at megawatt hours, still looks at energy, and it makes sense because it's energy. The overall target is carbon, but we still don't measure carbon for our energy policy. So what I mean by that is the renewable portfolio standard is a percentage of sales. And I think that's a perfectly good way to do it. But it doesn't measure the ultimate goal, the ultimate issue here. Same with energy efficiency. In fact, there have been proposals floated around in California by utilities to create carbon performance standards. So you have to have tons or pounds per megawatt hour, and you just have to get down to certain benchmarks. And you can get there however you want to get there. You can use efficiency, you can use renewables, you can use rooftop, you can use storage, but you can let the market tell you what's the best way to get there. I think that's an interesting area that we haven't quite come to terms with. I was in a meeting actually after the big storage dedication, and our Public Utilities Commission commissioner, President Picker, was there, and I brought this up, and I think and he acknowledged that it's an issue. We're still measuring megawatt hours when we should probably be measuring carbon. All right, I'm going to stop there. A few more slides, but I'm going to stop there. And I guess turn it over to Hillary. But anyway, thank you so much. Lots of food for thought. Do you have your own mic?
Good evening. I can't tell you how happy I am to be back in Denver. As Mark mentioned, I went to DU Law, so this is kind of a homecoming for me. So it's really nice to be here. It's nice that you all have a beer and you're laid back. I love this. So thanks again to Mark and Jacob for having me. I am the Policy and Strategy Manager at SDG&E, and I'm going to spend some time talking about a little bit more on the practitioner side. So once we get these wonderful new legislative policies, what do we do next? What happens when it gets to me? What happens when we have to actually implement some of these policies? Some of the key things we think about, the issues we face, and I'll give you some examples. I've most experience in the RPS world and energy efficiency. I'll give you some other examples of things that SDG&E has implemented to comply with California's policy goals. And I'll try to tell you about some of the just example of for each one on the most important challenge that I think we faced in implementing some of these policies. So, great. So I want to just start with telling you a little bit about SDG&E. So we serve about 1.4 million customers. So we're kind of small but mighty. And this year, our CEO introduced this new vision. And I wouldn't normally show the company vision. I'm, you know, not that wonky. But I really like this vision. He talks about, oh, thank you. that our company mission for 2017 is to improve lives and communities by building the cleanest, safest, and most reliable energy company in America. And I love that. I think that's, I really feel like that's a something that I can get excited about. So proud of that. And what does it mean for us to be the cleanest? As Scott kind of mentioned, we just recently had a ribbon cutting for the largest lithium ion storage facility in the world. So small but mighty. And we also had, as Scott mentioned, have over 100,000 rooftop solar facilities in SDG&E. We can interconnect those facilities within 3 days, which is the fastest in the state, if not the country. So we're making it easy for customers to go solar. And then last but not least, as Mark mentioned, we are today delivering 43% renewables to each and every customer in SDG&E service territory. So when I tell that to friends and family, I try to bring it home by like saying, that means everyone's home is getting almost half of their power from renewable resources. That's amazing. And when I started at SDG&E, we were probably at about 1 or 2%, and that was before I started, around 2002. So we've come an incredibly long way, and that was because we were able to strategize and collaborate with legislators and stakeholders like Scott and really work together to make that happen. So what are the things that we consider when we have to implement these new policies? Obviously, we have some really advanced, challenging policy goals in California. And as soon as those bills get passed, that's when I get excited, and I know that my work is about to begin. There's a lot more to do once those bills get to my desk. So obviously, the commission is typically charged with doing something That's when people like me and the energy division, commission staff start working on, okay, well, what was missing in the bill? What did they really mean? One of my favorite things to talk about is how important it is to really take the time to make sure that you're not making sure that you understand the language and drafted. So one thing that we're dealing with right now is the fact that we now have declining energy sales. So maybe 5-10 years ago, when we got a new mandate from the legislature that said something like, we want you to procure 20% biomass in your RPS or some mandate like that, we would maybe argue about, well, was that cost effective and is that the right technology? But there wasn't any concern about whether we needed the power. We had growth, the economy was great, things were increasing, so that wasn't part of the reality. And today, that's not the case. So we don't have growth right now. We're full on resources. We're flush. We're good. So when we get additional mandates, that's just another factor that we have to consider, is that there may not be a need for additional power. So maybe that's something we have to, what are the other reasons that we need to change our composition of power or whatever the climate goal is? Another obvious one is reliability. I think Scott touched on that, so I won't belabor that too much, but obviously what customers really want is when they flip the light switch for the lights to go on. So that's definitely something that we bring to the table in the implementation phase of these policy initiatives. Technological innovation, Scott mentioned this too a bit, I think. Tesla Powerwalls are out there, Nest thermostats, distributed generation, solar on the roof, all of these things have an impact. And potentially could change the utility's business model. So of course, those things are on our mind as we're trying to implement these policy initiatives. And last but not least, reasonable rates. So we're going to try to do all of these things. We're going to, have 50% renewables. We're going to double energy efficiency. We're going to do all these things without causing SDG&E ratepayers to protest in the streets because of high rates. So that's the goal. So that's definitely another key factor that we have on our minds when we're implementing. just Scott talked a lot already about SB 350, which is, I think he called it SB 32, but same idea. We've got giant goals to reduce GHGs. I've put a couple other examples of legislation here, AB 793, SB 43, just to give you a flavor of, it's not always that broad. I think SB 350 did a nice job of really being all-encompassing. So it talks about renewables, it talks about energy efficiency, it talks about electric transportation, storage, all in one bill to try to reduce GHGs. That's great. I like that. We also get really specific legislation that's more one-off. So this one, AB 793, was a really specifically targeted bill to make sure that we are communicating and educating and marketing to customers effectively about all this new technology, energy management technologies. Super specific. SB 43 was another one that was geared just towards community solar, which I know that's something that you guys already have here in Colorado, but we were second on that one. But so there's a mix of broad and specific bills that we get. So I'll go into now some of the examples of how we've implemented these things. I won't spend too much time on RPS. I know most of you are pretty familiar with the issues we get there, but I just wanted to show this picture because this is I think it's about 26 megawatt solar farm in Borrego Springs that I helped negotiate the power purchase agreement for, so I'm quite proud of that one. It's beautiful. But so issues that we faced in implementing RPS, it was just a whole lot of details. You know, if you're trying to get to a certain percentage by a certain year, well, do you do it all at once? Do you have intermediate targets? Do you allow fuel cells to count? And then the thing that I would really emphasize here is we were able, because of the legislation, the way it was written, there was enough flexibility there for us to pivot many times in the course of the 10 years that we got to where we are now. So for example, at one point, at a certain point, we realized that we were in excess of our goal. So we had procured in excess of that current year's target. And we're sitting in the room thinking, well, how can we maximize this? How can we, you know, make this the most cost-effective program for customers? Well, maybe we should think about selling. So we were able to work with the energy division, with the commission on, they had enough flexibility from the legislation for us to work with them on, okay, well, what are the rules on selling? And we didn't have to go back to the legislature because there was enough flexibility. So that was really key. We had things like that come up along the way, and we had the energy division and the commission were given enough authority to be able to work things like that out. So we're also dealing with a giant goal to double energy efficiency in California. So the main issue that we deal with in the implementation of energy efficiency programs is attribution. So we spend a whole lot of time, and I'm sure some of you are familiar with this issue, but just trying to figure out whether the utilities program actually caused a customer to change their light bulb or put in a more efficient air conditioning system. So tons of resources, tons of time spent on that question, and it's a really tricky one. So there's different legislation that now that's trying to switch things to more of a metered-based way of counting savings. You know, hopefully there's a way out of that mess, but it's a really difficult question. What are we doing? So this picture here on the building a better energy efficient future, that's the cover page to a nearly 400-page document that we just filed in January that outlines our plan for the next 10 years to try to double energy efficiency. So just keep in mind the poor practitioner when you are thinking about how to legislate these things. 400 pages. I think it could have been a little simpler. We also are looking at clean transportation. So this is also from SB 350. Although SDG&E kind of is out in front on this one as well. We love electric vehicles. We had our own initiative, Power Your Drive, which sought permission from the commission to get 3,500 charging stations in San Diego. Some of them had to be in disadvantaged communities. And then SB 350 also requires us to do some things with energy or electric vehicles. The main issue that I'm hearing from our electric vehicle folks in implementing SB 350's electric vehicle requirements is just the sheer volume of initiatives that were outlined in legislation. So I'm told that there are 21 different initiatives associated with electric vehicles in SB 350, seven of which are just for SDG&E. And as much as we love that, I think, you know, we will be pushing and we will be working towards meeting all of those. We are wondering whether there's enough bandwidth in the state, at the commission, at the utilities, with the stakeholders to make those happen. Because it is a drain, I think Scott can probably attest, to get through this, to really get through this in a way that makes it work, like I think we did with RPS, requires tons of workshops, tons of time sitting down with each other and actually understanding what the other person is saying. So keep that in mind when you're, you know, don't bite off more than you can chew, I guess, is the way, you know, if you really want this to work, it takes time. It takes people sitting down and really trying to understand each other. So here's our storage goals. It's another big part of SB 350 and other legislation that mandates that we procure a certain amount of storage. You'll notice here that it's not just storage, it's different flavors of storage. So we have transmission level, distribution level, and customer-sided storage requirements. I think one of our main questions right now is whether, how aggressive to be right now, or if we should be waiting. We have until 2020. So I think we're right now trying to make those decisions about, you know, are there excellent opportunities in the market now, or should we wait a couple of years and see how much things change? This is one of those that's just really early. So we're struggling with that. And obviously price is the big factor there. So again, remembering we don't want protests in the streets. We're trying to decide whether now is the right time or if prices may come down. And this is just pure bragging, again, about our storage facility that we just had the ribbon cutting on. So we're just really excited about this opportunity. I hope it's I'm wondering if it's on what part of Scott's curve we're on with our storage facility here, but it's, I think, about 20 megawatts, and we'll be participating in the ISO. So this is going to be a really good example for people to watch to see, does it solve problems? Does it help with the duck belly? You know, is this really what it's cracked up to? So the last example I have here is our community solar program, and we actually consulted with Xcel Energy to get some actual, you know, we were learning from you guys on this one, but there's some other interesting background on this is that SDG&E, again, kind of was out in front on this one and proposed this program to the commission in 2011 or 12 or so. And they liked it so much that the legislature then got on board and required that all the IOUs in California offer these types of programs. So that was interesting. Slowed us down a little bit, but that's okay. It was good. The probably biggest issue that we faced with this one is making sure that only participating customers are paying for these programs. So this type of program is, how many of you are familiar with community solar? Great. So, you know, So if a developer comes and builds a 1 megawatt facility somewhere in San Diego and only gets enough customer participation to buy about half of it, well, SDG&E has to pick up that whole 1 megawatt. And that means there's a potential for non-participating customers, folks that didn't want to be in this community solar program, to have to pay for some of it. So that was a big challenge for us, trying to make sure that only the participating customers picked up the costs for these facilities. So I guess the main takeaways, I guess, for what I've learned as a practitioner is take the time to talk. That's, I can't emphasize that enough, to make sure that you're, bring a practitioner into your discussion for half an hour, just a half an hour, you know, explain to them what you're doing, what you're thinking, what, make sure that you're using the same language, that you're actually understanding what each other are talking about, and then keeping it simple. So time to have going to work. I think that's about all I wanted to say, so I'm hoping we can have a good conversation.
Scott, Hillary, thank you very much. Let's just get right to audience questions. But before that, I just want to say it's so refreshing to hear a real-world utility expert, someone who works with a utility company, stand up and express glee and excitement about progress and about meeting the challenges instead of saying, oh, this will never work, this is too problematic. So good on the state of California for its policy leadership, good on SDG&E for its leadership. Let's just get right to questions. We have a mic, a roving mic right here. So let's take this gentleman in this row right here.
So you pointed out that electricity demand has been flat or even decreasing. Your solar installation's going up tremendously. So how are you dealing with all the stranded generation assets?
That's a great question, and a huge challenge for us. So we have some existing regulations, you know, some existing processes where we're allowed to try to collect rates to cover for stranded assets, but I'm not sure that system is equipped for what we have going on now. So that's a current discussion that's going on in our commission and around the utilities as to how we can fix that system. But we haven't fixed that yet.
Lauren, what are the average residential rates in SDG&E's service area? And Scott, what are they California-wide? Do you guys have a fix on that?
I think around, you know, mid-teens. Depending on the class. Does that sound about right?
Yeah, it depends. It depends on how much you consume because it's a tiered structure, but I want to say it's in the 15 to 20 cent range for residential customers in our territory, is SDG tiered. I'm not sure about California as a whole, but I'm guessing it's roughly in that same area.
Our bills here will have one rate.
No, that would be all in. And if I could respond quickly to the previous a lot of, in California, a lot of the utilities purchase a significant amount of their energy because after the energy crisis, well, during the energy crisis, they, or I should say, during deregulation, hold it closer, sorry, during deregulation, utilities divested their generation assets. So, for example, SDG&E has very few generation assets. So most of their supply is procured through purchases. Now, they still have those contracts. Some of them are market purchases, but I'm not sure that there are huge stranded assets because of the current changes. If there's a lot of departing load, that might change.
I saw in Mr. Andrews' chart feed-in tariffs. To what extent are feed-in tariffs being used in California, or have they been used?
Let me go first. So we did have I believe they're closed, but we did have feed-in tariffs for renewables, small-scale renewables. And I think to some degree of success, but we focused those tariffs on smaller renewables, which I think was a not as robust of a market. So especially in SDG&E service territory, it's just really hard to find to make those projects work. There's just the land costs are really expensive in SDG&E, and so that wasn't incredibly successful just because we were focused on that small scale. But may have worked better in other parts of the state, may work better in other parts of the country.
Someone asked, what are they? Feed-in tariff is a structure under which if you build a generating facility, whether a small one or a large one, you are guaranteed a rate for the power you sell into the grid. Feed-in tariff is a bit of a misnomer. They're very problematic and not very much used in the United States because of the federal government's control over the wholesale energy market. They're very difficult to find jurisdictions where they'll work.
Yeah, California had a limited one, but we in California and many places around the states use a net metering arrangement where you basically are offsetting your retail rate.
Let's go to this gentleman here.
So, you know, when you have a duck curve like you showed, and that looks like a really radical one to me, that can play all kinds of havoc with, you know, number one, the real-time markets, it can drive the prices below zero. And I'm wondering if that happens. And the other thing that I'm thinking might happen is that there's now not enough incentive to build the generation that you do need. Now, I guess if load's not growing, that's not a problem. But are either of those things a problem? What do you do about it?
I think the short answer to the first part of your question is yes, we have seen negative prices in the wholesale market. Again, it's not all the time. And in terms of incentives for building new infrastructure, that has been, I mean, those questions have been raised in different contexts, but right now we are flush, generally speaking, because what has happened is as the renewables are coming on, they're in the belly of the duck would have normally been the gas that we already have. So I think we have a pretty good, I don't want to say too much, but I think that at the current time, particularly with flat or declining load, I don't think new capacity is an issue. Yet, of course.
Is this on? California was a pioneer in creating a cap and trade system. And has drawn in other states, even other nations. Quebec is a member. My view would be great if Colorado became a member. But the whole point of a cap and trade system is that it provides consistent incentives across the system to reduce emissions, whether it's by energy efficiency or fuel efficiency, or any flavor of renewables or fuel switching. But then what you've done in California, it sounds like, is you've overlaid this like raft of SB, this, that, and the other thing, which are not necessarily at all consistent, let alone cost effective.
Yes, I hope. Yeah,
there has to be a question in here somewhere.
I can answer.
Would you recommend that Colorado actually not go down that road?
I can certainly comment on, and I had a couple slides on cap and trade, but I was too long anyway. But cap and trade, it's interesting, right? Because if you look at California, we already have a renewable portfolio standard. We already have rooftop solar. We already have tailpipe emission standards. We already have the low carbon fuel standard. We already have this whole panoply of regulations that really drive most of the reductions. Then you have this, what we often call is the backstop. Maybe the cap and trade system is kind of the backstop. And it does pick up other parts of the economy, but it's not necessarily the only lever that we're pushing. And so it does become this kind of patchwork quilt. I think you're absolutely right. I did have a couple slides on the cap and trade. Interestingly, the most recent, so California is expecting many, many billions of dollars of revenue through the cap and trade system. And in recent months, we've haven't gotten the allowances haven't sold, and they haven't fetched much income. The last one fetched $8 million, which is hundreds of millions below its expectation.
Yes, but you've done what the Europeans have done. They've undermined the system with all of this. So the permit price in Europe is like, you know, under $10 or around $10. And this is the same in California. Obviously, there's no revenue.
Yeah, at the moment, emissions are below the cap. So it's the system is there's a problem with the system here. And there is some discussion in California around a carbon tax. And I don't know if there's enough political will to switch things around. But you raise valid points about California's cap and trade system.
It's kind of going off his question and what you just mentioned, your thoughts on a carbon tax and how that would kind of replace a cap and trade system. And then with that, there's talks of income from a carbon tax. Would you think that the state would handle that income and do what they think, or do more of a hand it back to the, you know, the residents of the state to lower their electricity bills or what have you?
One of my slides was showing where we are currently putting our cap and trade revenue and where we'd like to if we got it. And, you know, in our case, most of it goes to greenhouse gas reduction programs. High-speed rail is a very controversial recipient of those monies. There's also a large amount dedicated to disadvantaged communities, as I mentioned earlier. So that's what California's doing. So cap and trade versus tax, I mean, that's a whole night's discussion. But I would say that generally speaking, the nice thing about a cap and trade is that there's a cap, right? And then the market kind of figures out how to do that. On the tax side, you're setting the tax, but you're not sure how much reduction you're going to get. So they're kind of sort of mirrors of themselves or opposites of themselves. I mean, I'll tell you my personal opinion. I mean, I think economists generally agree that the carbon tax is probably the cleaner way to do it. I think the carbon tax has problems too, right? You don't just set the number and you're done. I think you have to do some adjustment in there as well. I think that cap and trade, I was really worried about cap and trade as it was developing right after the big economic downturn and right after the Enron crisis in California. You know, if a system can be gamed, it will be gamed, and the cap and trade system is very complicated. So I'm a general believer in simplicity. In any case, that's my own personal view. In terms of the revenue, I don't have an opinion. I know that there's a movement for a tax and dividend, which would create a carbon tax, collect the revenue, and send it back to everybody in the form of an income tax reduction or some other way to get or just lump sum back. Funny story: right after graduate school, I worked in D.C. at a think tank. And we worked on carbon taxes, of all things, back in the mid-90s. It was not very popular. But our mantra was tax bads, not goods. And why, you know, don't tax income. Why would you tax income? You want to tax things you want to get less of. So tax pollution, and then use that money to offset income taxes. You want more income, not less income. So anyway, I think that's compelling logic. I think that it's much more complicated than that. So I think there's a movement for this cap and dividend concept. But I think that when you see the potential revenues, I think the government, you know, establishment is going to have a hard time keeping their hands off of that revenue.
Hillary, I don't want to make you have to call home and ask somebody, but can you express an opinion on what SDG&E's views might be on a carbon tax?
Not specifically on the carbon tax, but I do want to bring it back a little bit to what I think this gentleman was asking, and relating to carbon tax, or is it cap and trade, what both of them have in common is that it's GHG reduction is the goal. And I don't want to lose that point, because I think that's a lesson to learn from what we may have bungled a bit in California, where we have so many different requirements for different resource types, solar requirement, storage requirement, electric vehicle requirement. And the practitioner story, to bring it home, is I have to hold a meeting once a week with all of the leaders from each of those little groups within the utility that are trying to meet those different regulations, and we all have to first spend about 10 minutes figuring out, defining terms to figure out what each other are talking about, because we're not reading each other's legislation. And then we have to talk about things like, well, what's the most cost-effective way to reduce GHG? And no, I mean, it's just, it's a very, very difficult situation.
One final thought about the cap and trade system. It's only authorized through 2020. And between the time when it was, I guess, authorized in legislation AB 32 in 2006 and today, we had a ballot initiative to require a two-thirds majority for any tax in California. And so going forward, that's going to require a two-thirds vote of the legislature to. And another thing that's happening is advocates of disadvantaged communities are saying, you know, and legislators are saying, we will not vote for this unless we deal with this issue. So that's it's a big fight right now in our legislature.
We have a question here. Let's keep them quick because we can get a couple more in if we do them quick here.
Yep. I'm wondering if you could tell us a little bit about what's happening in San Diego on the gas side of your utility.
Good question.
On the gas side?
Yeah.
What can I say about the gas side? Well, I mean, we have a sister utility that it's SoCal Gas, and so I think they have a very unique perspective on electrification, and it's a challenging conversation for that side of the house, I think. But they have some really good, you know, some vision there as well, and clean natural gas, and all of those efforts are still moving forward.
Stick this gentleman here, and then one more in the back here. Thank you.
Okay, if you two were in charge and you had the authority in California, where would you go to get reduce greenhouse gas emissions the most cost effectively today, with what you two know? You get to be king and queen.
The most cost-effective way to reduce greenhouse gases, if I could decide, man.
Inside California.
Wow. I mean, energy efficiency, it's hard for me to see past the electric sector, but, you know, energy efficiency, like the kilowatt hour saved is the greenest kilowatt hour, you know, that's probably where my head goes first. But there's some major challenges to how we measure that and how, you know, should ratepayers pay for things that customers may have done anyway. And there's, you know, just, we get tangled up very quickly there. But I do think that that's,
make a one sentence comment.
That's the cleanest way to do it.
So I'll dodge your question, and I'll admit to doing it. No, so there are two sides of this analysis. One is the quantity or the potential that can be reduced and the cost of reducing it. And we've done a ton of analysis, and there are certain super cost-effective things like retiming traffic signals. It's like super cost-effective. Retro-commissioning existing buildings. That's going back into an existing building and like fine-tuning the system so they work as they were designed to work. There's no capital cost. It's all sort of labor. Super cost effective. The problem is that they don't get you very much. So I think that Jacob said at the beginning, this is a big problem. It is a big problem. If you want to get to two, there is a concern about cost effectiveness. I get it, and we do analysis and we hear it all the time. But the reality is, if you want to get those big, deep, if you really want to decarbonize, deep decarbonization, you have to go where the emissions are. You know, I tell people that old bank robber, right? They said, why do you rob banks? He said, because that's where the money is. And if you want to know where to reduce emissions, it's transportation and energy production.
All right, last question back here.
One comment, I borrowed the mic. Dollar for dollar, the best investment you can make to avoid greenhouse gas emissions is to avoid an unwanted pregnancy. That's true.
Yes, it is. China's one-child policy has had a greater impact on the reduction of carbon emissions than any policy of any other government in the world.
But I'm not going to run on that platform.
No. John, thank you. Yeah.
So you had mentioned about the hype curve. How do you incentivize venture capitalists to invest in startup companies when the ROI for a startup might be much smaller time frame than actually a market might mature for adoption of a technology.
I'm sorry, I missed the first part of your question.
You mentioned the hype curve.
Yeah.
And so how do you incentivize a venture capitalist to invest in startups when the venture capitalist wants an ROI on their money and the market hasn't matured yet? Because it could be a really slow moving market. Any suggestions?
I don't have any great suggestions, but what I will tell you is that what California is doing is there is a program called EPIC, not our EPIC, but or my EPIC, but we got there first. But they have, it's ratepayer funding for research and development, and it's, again, lots and lots of money, hundreds of millions of dollars. And they have programs along those lines. But what they're starting to do now is building what they're calling the ecosystem of entrepreneurship around energy innovation in California. And so there's a program in San Diego that we're part of, which tries to help early stage companies kind of through the pipeline to get services as quickly. I can't speak for the venture capitalist. I don't know what would help, you know, that concern.
Other than really, really well drafted legislation that
yeah, I mean the ten, you know,
spurs the market.
Exactly. The California Solar Initiative, 10 years, $2 billion with rates being reduced in a published way. That really goes a long way to say, look, we're not there yet, but we see a pathway. There's a glide path here that we can get on. But that's hard too.
Let's thank Hillary and Scott so much for coming out tonight. And I know you guys will hang around for a little while afterwards if you want to address questions directly to them. Jacob?
Yep, I've got just a few really quick things. First is Senator Andy Kerr joined us. Senator Andy Kerr and Senator Matt Jones, these are the folks that can make things happen in the legislature. So we're very grateful you guys are here tonight. Second thing is a huge thanks to Serendipity Catering and Jillian over there for the food and the wine and the beer and the coffee. The third is, under your butt is one of these cards. And if you could take just a couple of minutes to fill that out, we'd be very grateful. You can also do it online if you'd prefer to do that. And just two last things. Our Heroes of Sustainability event is our big annual gala, April 27th. We've got information as you walk out through the doors there. Please grab it. Think about coming. We've got sponsorship opportunities. It's a terrific time. We're going to be focused on green buildings and opportunities to make the built environment a crucial part of how we save the planet from climate change. And then finally, if you still want another drink, Jillian's over there. You can grab a drink and feel free to linger here as long as you like, chatting with other folks who are here. Thank you all so much for coming, and thanks to you guys for being here.
Next time I come here, I think I'll shave. Maybe you'll let me ask a question. Okay, so the thing is, we wouldn't be here if there wasn't this speech. That was like a breakthrough. So basically, it was a government mandate that we're going to be promoting this change. So it seems to me that there must have been opposition, even in California, that would say, let the market lead these changes. So what was your counter argument to that?
I don't disagree. I mean, that's one of the reasons I said earlier that we have carbon tax. The market, there is a way to do that. We didn't get into a lot of detail, but Hillary talked about the super complicated world. And I just feel like it could be served by a market. I also feel like the distributed charger area, as it leads into the grid, there's a role for a market. The problem is,